sounded like you were almost ready to push ahead, so be very careful that, you are thinking your eighth notes. Now, harmonically. Okay, that's from the other page. Can we just look really quickly at the first page? Yeah, we just have the first, yeah, this is kind of tricky. You can see here what's going on in the strings. We don't have a whole lot going on, right? Mm-hmm. Can we have the next page, please, Claire? Okay. Nothing much is changing. You can see, right? Now, but the interesting thing about it is when you start the second part of the solo, look what's happening. Now we're starting to get some harmonic motion here. So, what does that mean? What does that mean for you as a solo player?
Lead and go more.
Exactly. You've got an opportunity to make your line more interesting. So maybe warm up a vibrato, maybe make a little bit more of a crescendo, right? Now, what happens here when you get to the next part of the solo? What's going on? You've got the solo line. Yeah, who's playing with you? Exactly. So you're no longer the only line. Yes, you're the leading voice, but you have to be aware that you're playing a duet. Okay, that's important. Now, when I first started playing this, I used to play this first statement louder and make an echo, because that's the way that I was originally coached to do it. A number of years ago, Jesus Lopez Cobos, fabulous, wonderful, wonderful musician, great conductor, was conducting us in this at the Bowl. And he said to me at the break, he said, you know, I've got a copy of an autograph of Dvorak's score, autograph score, and he said, I want to show you something here. And he said, I realize that you're making an echo, but he said, I want to show you why that isn't going to work. Because he said, the first time through, the strings are marked pianissimo. Then, the next two bars, they're marked piano. So he said, if you are making an echo the second time, it's not going to balance well. So he said, would you please play the first two bars a little bit softer, and then play your next two bars a little bit louder, and then everything will balance well. I said, okay, great, that makes perfect sense to me. I was happy to do that. Now, what's the benefit of that? Can you think of any benefit of having your second two bars here a little bit louder?
Nice pianissimo.
Exactly. It makes it much, much easier to convince everyone that you're playing incredibly softly here. So it's kind of a sleight of hand. Yeah, so I would love to have you make that difference. Plus, I think if you play the same volume both times, I'm sorry, that's a little bit boring. Okay, the last thing I want to talk to you about is the final What are you doing there? What's the challenge?
Well, you're getting louder and crescendo, and then you're going up into the higher range of the instrument.
Right, and where is the peak of your phrase? Where are you going?
To the B flat.
To the B flat, okay, that's exactly where you're going. Now, what is the challenge of doing that?
The B flat softer than the C.
Okay, so what are you going to do about that?
You've got to make the C softer.
Or you have to
make
the
B flat.
Yes, now remember when I was talking, I believe it was yesterday, about adding the D key of your right hand for your high B flat to help make it more stable. I find that that gives me the ability to really blow through that B flat without the tendency of it going sharp and getting thin. Would you try that for me? Okay, you can put more air through it than that, can't you? Now, how does that feel compared to playing the regular B flat without the added finger? You feel kind of a difference now? It really wants to go sharp. Now, would you play this line going and use the third key, or the third finger for that D flat, and see what you can do? Right, you have to have the sense of really spiraling.